Hachette Audio presents Initiated, Memoir of a Witch. Written and read by me, Amanda Yates Garcia. Dedication. For my mother, for the mother, for all my witch sisters, brothers, and cousins across the world, for all our ancestors going back in deep time, healers, seers, lovers, artists, oracles, inventors, wise ones, I see you. I love you. I honor you. Caveats. This audiobook is an alchemical mixture of memoir, mythology, manifesto, theory, visions, and dreams. As in dreams, sometimes it was necessary to bend time, make grand leaps between events. I had to keep some stories hidden in my book of shadows to be told another time. Sometimes mythological figures that may be familiar to you surface here in unorthodox forms. All this is to be expected in a book written by a witch. As unconventional, unorthodox, and alchemical as these stories may be, they are also true. For behold, I have been with you from the beginning, and I am that which is attained at the end of desire. Doreen Valiente, as adapted by Starhawk, The Charge of the Star Goddess. Now I, woman, am going to blow up the law, an explosion henceforth possible and ineluctable. Let it be done, right now, in language. Alain Sixou, The Laugh of the Medusa. Prologue. When you are in your trouble and turn from death, this is what to do. Find the meeting place, intersectionality, under stars, way to gnosis, saying this is the place, this is indeed the place, with many layers, lie down here. Anne Waldman, Trickster Feminism. Search for the three stars that make up the belt of Orion. I squinted through the starlight, tracing my finger along a line of instructions I'd written in my book of shadows, the place where witches inscribe their favorite spells. Alone, at a crossroads, deep in the Mojave Desert, it was to the constellation of Orion that I was to address my invocation. Into the night, I chanted. Eowoth, Abroath, Basim, Issac, Sabaoth, Io! Hot winds seared up from the borderlands near Mexico. My candles in their safety glass sputtered and died. I clamped down on the pages of my notebook, lest they vanish into the spectral scrub surrounding me on all sides. I was in the desert to perform the headless rite, an arcane piece of ceremonial magic where you declare yourself divine. You call down the goddess Isis to enter you. You speak in her voice. I am the one who makes the lightning flash and the thunder roll. I am the one whose sweat falls upon the earth as rain so that life can begin. I was there because I didn't want to, because I could not play by the rules of the status quo anymore. I was done capitulating. The headless rite was to be the last in a series of magical initiations I saw myself as having begun at birth. Barefoot and virtually naked, the sheer cotton dress I used during my solitary rituals snapped around my legs like wolves in the dark. I stood inside a towering cove of red rocks, each a million years old and warm to the touch, still radiating the sun's heat at midnight. Spiny fields of jumping cactus, luminous in the starlight, formed a sea around me, waiting to leap out and pierce my bare legs with their thorns. It was dangerous land. Rattlesnakes, coyotes skulking through the creosote brambles. But I was mostly worried about the desert dwellers. Macho, meth-addled young men in their monster trucks, out there somewhere guzzling 40s, howling their bloodlust into the desert void. Like most women and femmes, witches are familiar with the demons of patriarchy. They follow us everywhere. Even out in the desert wilderness, we can't be alone in our rights. The shadow of violence falls unbidden, and for many of us, just the threat of it, the lifetime of warnings to be careful, the accumulation of micro and macro assaults are enough to keep us home, safe, under the protective aegis of the patriarchal father gods. Every time I saw headlights advancing along the horizon, or heard the low growl of a motorcycle bounce off the canyon walls, I fought the urge to run and hide. But I would not be chased from my magic by bad boy bros who thought they owned the world. I was there on principle. I was there out of a commitment to create the kind of world I wanted to live in. A world where witches raise power in the desert. A world where a woman could chant hymns to the goddess miles away from civilization without worrying that she might be attacked. So I chanted my incantations and spattered my libations into the red earth and tried not to think about how I'd never had to test my magic against men who, should they appear, I felt sure would have guns. I've always made it a policy to do things that scare me. An initiation is a beginning, a rite of passage. A ceremony that signals an advance of some kind, into adulthood or a new form of knowledge. During my ceremonial initiation into witchcraft on my 13th birthday, my mother and I sat with a skein of red cord binding my wrist to hers inside a circle of mothers and daughters from our community. Called the Rite of Roses, for the rose wands our mothers brushed against our dewy young cheeks, this was the ceremony for the adolescent witches of my coven as we dedicated our lives to the goddess and to each other. Lit by the glow of red candles, bouquets of roses festooned with ferns and puffs of baby's breath perfumed our living room. Women and girls warmed the room like coals. We were there to celebrate our blood, that life force that passes through our veins, throbbing its way back to the beginning of all life on Earth, carrying us forward into the unknown future we must create for ourselves. That night, we chanted the names of our matrilineal ancestors, beginning as far back into the historical mist as we could reach. When we finally spoke my mother's name, and then mine, we used a pair of scissors as an athame, a ceremonial knife, to cut the red umbilicus that bound us together. I was now my own woman, a free agent. To celebrate, we took a walk through an overgrown suburban park, the full moon transmuting my girlfriends and me into silhouettes as we skipped ahead, giggling through the weeds. It was an initiation in name only. I was still just a girl, and my life was about to explode. Since then, I've learned that more than any formal initiation ceremony given to you by an authority, your true initiation process is the one life creates just for you. Your life initiates you to the work that only you can do. You don't need to be born to a witch mother or receive an initiation from a high priestess to become a witch. You just need to pay attention to the lessons the goddess is teaching you through your own experiences, and then rise up and take action. Furthermore, witchcraft isn't just for women. It's for men and trans folks and fairy creatures and animal spirits and anything in between. You don't need to menstruate or have a uterus to be a witch. You can find your power in being whoever you are. However, throughout this book, I refer to witches as she because that's my pronoun, and also because this book is a love letter to the femmes of the world. If you're not a femme, this book is still for you. Any lover of the goddess is welcome here, and even those who are just questioning. In his book, Rites and Symbols of Initiation, anthropologist Mircea Eliade says that puberty initiations usually begin with an act of rupture. The child is separated from her mother. Persephone is dragged down to Hades, a brutal process. Yet, in ancient Greece, the Eleusinian mysteries were rites of initiation almost everyone chose to perform. Initiates were sworn to secrecy, killed if they ever spoke or wrote of their experience. In the 4th century Common Era, Christian invaders came from the north. They tore down the temple at Eleusis, ground the remains into dust, and built their churches on the rubble. Hardly any record remains of the Eleusinian mysteries, but we do know they were in honor of Demeter, goddess of the harvest, and Persephone, her maiden daughter who was abducted to hell by the lord of the underworld, where she was forced to be his bride. Ready or not, our traumas drag us into the underworld, initiating us, often unwillingly, into the mysteries of sex and death, and eventually, hopefully, if we're lucky, rebirth. The latter only if somehow, by our wiles, we manage to escape.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.